gonna show 'em where it's at.
Don't you ever challenge a curse. Don't you ever rub your nose in a curse. You're asking for it.
You work the tail off.
5 seconds left.
Four, are you dreaming?
Three, four.
That was great.
Haven't had any two pressure 2 weeks.
Four. A curse is dark magic that has been brought against somebody. A curse is just evil in that person's life.
Curses aren't just something witches use to turn a prince into a frog. They are something that has prevented teams from winning in the NFL.
Fans believe in jinxes and curses because it's easier than admitting we stink.
There's a reason why the ball isn't bouncing our way or hasn't bounced our way for 20 years.
It's a power above me, above all.
I just jinxes, man. Man.
I do believe in curses. I do believe that people have the ability to curse people. You have to be a gypsy.
Barry Caulfield broke the curse!
If you don't believe in jinxes and curses and you're a football fan, then I don't know what you do on your Sundays, because they're absolutely real, and I've got the lucky socks to prove it.
There's a gleam, man! There's a gleam!
We've got our lucky socks and horseshoes.
Anybody with a horseshoe can hit.
No broken mirrors or walking under ladders here.
That's scary.
For some teams, if it wasn't for bad luck, they'd have no luck at all. This is Top 10 Football Curses.
We gotta exercise that curse.
The number 10 football curse of all time. The curse of the honey bears.
Don't mess with the pack of ladies. That's never gonna end well.
You don't want to piss off a bunch of hot chicks, no.
I mean, it was a whole lot of women scorned.
In 1977, George Halas told his associates, "I want dancing girls on our sidelines." He didn't want to be upstaged by the Dallas Cowboys. He wanted to have the best cheerleaders in the NFL.
And those honey bears, I gave them tremendous credit, because those outfits were not too big, and it was freezing up there.
That was a classy lot.
Just punch up honey bears on your computer. Take a gander.
Halas told his associates, "As long as I'm alive, we will have dancing girls on the sidelines of Bears games."
George Halas passed away in 1983. His daughter took over, and the dancing girls' days were numbered.
Virginia McCaskey decided that she didn't like the idea of having cheerleaders being a part of their team.
I believe there's a perception in the organization that somehow cheerleaders are sexist and don't belong in football stadiums.
Honey Bears contract ran through 1985, a year where their presence spurred the Bears to one of the greatest seasons ever.
It was a carnival. You had a great team filled with personalities. You had hot-looking women in hot-looking outfits.
That was their last year as cheerleaders here, 85.
And all of a sudden, mysteriously like that, they were gone.
How do you eradicate the Chicago Bears Honey Bears cheerleading squad? They've never won since.
Coincidence? I don't think so.
As they walked out the door, through their pom-poms with a finger up, they said, "You will never win the game!"
There was no dynasty in the making. The next three seasons, the Honey Bears smiled as the Bears exited the playoffs with a home loss each year.
It is odd that after they took them out, they couldn't even with that team, you know, continue on.
It's got to be the Honey Bears. Buddy Randle even had nothing to do with it.
When McMahon was, getting hurt, he was going, "Those darn Honey Bears! I wish they were here!"
What's the obvious thing to do? Bring back the Honey Buns. All we got is an ugly bear out there. I mean, that's not good.
Halas is turning in his grave. Honestly, the Honey Bears were rocking.
Hallis loved the Honey Bears? And we're not respecting his wishes? This is just a travesty. Ginny, get with the program. Come on. Georgie Boy wanted the Honey Bears.
Chicago, if a jinx gets put on you, it's going to stay for a while. Just ask the Cubs.
He's there in the darkness. You may never leave the darkness alive.
Up next, a curse that has had one team living in darkness for a century.
It's karma, you know what I'm saying? It's karma. What goes around comes around, now it's coming back on us.
Some curses were meant to be broken. The Tampa curse stated no team that lost to the Bucs in the regular season would win a Super Bowl. It lasted until 2009, when the Saints were the first to do so. The next year, Aaron Rodgers helped end another jinx.
When he came out of college, we were all talking about the Jeff Tedford curse and how no quarterbacks who had ever been with Tedford in college had ever succeeded at the NFL level. You had Bowler, and you had Achilles Smith, and you had Joey Harrington. And Aaron Rodgers, we looked at him and we said, oh no, this isn't going to be another one of these guys, is it? And he absolutely is not another one of those guys.
Our number nine jinx may be over for the town, but not their NFL team.
Number nine football curse of all time, the curse of Billy Penn.
I don't know if you want to talk about the so-called curse of Billy Penn, but I'd love to get into that.
Well, the Eagles are in trouble. They are in trouble. Incomplete off the hands of Deuce Staley.
All they knew was somebody said that that guy on top of City Hall is the reason that we're not winning anymore.
This is scary.
Billy's up there for a reason. Billy's looking down on everybody right now like, how dare you challenge me?
For the sake of the emotional health of this entire area, things better change for the Eagles.
And until I say fit, you will lose forever.
In 1681, William Penn was granted the land that became Pennsylvania. And over the years, a gentleman's agreement stated that no building in the city of Philadelphia would rise above his statue atop City Hall.
So the curse of Billy Penn supposedly started in 1987, right? Because they finally built taller than Billy Penn.
And the suggestion is, I'll show you, I'll see to it that you never succeed. How dare you shadow me with these ostentatious buildings?
The evidence of our number nine football curse of all time first became apparent in 1988 with the Fog Bowl.
I believe the Bears would have lost had the fog not rolled in.
The Eagles that year would have won the Super Bowl if they get out of Chicago.
3 years later, Philadelphia's Super Bowl expectations were once again shattered.
Randall Cunningham is down on the field. Talk about nightmares.
If Cunningham doesn't get hurt, who knows where that team goes?
Even the Eagles' all-time winningest coach couldn't get past Billy Penn.
They need to get rid of McNabb. They need to get rid of Reed.
Andy Reid made only one Super Bowl appearance, which he lost.
A painful, painful defeat.
After competing in five NFC Championship games.
McNabb is sacked.
He is shaken up. Donovan must really be hurting.
I mean, not only did the Eagles lose in all these NFC Championship games, but they lost badly.
Fires, and it's intercepted. And the minute he grabbed that football, you could hear nothing in this stadium.
The whole town is decimated. Food doesn't taste good. You build a skyscraper and your city sports fortunes go down the drain. Your life ends. Your girlfriend's ugly. I mean, you're doomed.
We should have won. Damn it, we should have won this game.
You know,
damn it. We should have won this game. No timeout, nothing.
I do think that there needs to be some homage to this history of broken promises that I'm talking about.
As a member of the Quaker religion, William Penn has room in his heart for forgiveness.
Now, Comcast, they put a little Billy Penn statue at the top of the Comcast building, which is the tallest building in the city of Philadelphia, and then the Phillies won a world championship.
However, while the Phillies have made peace with William Penn, Our number 9 football curse of all time continues to plague the Eagles.
This is as devastating an Eagles loss as I can remember in a long, long time.
There are a lot of people here that still believe that the curse of Billy Penn is real and does exist.
The last time the Eagles won it all, guess where it was? It was at the field, the home field of the Penn Quakers.
The Eagles hold the Packers the rest of the way to win their first world championship since 1949.
Hey, baby, Chuck Bednarik, a Penn Quaker. It's all coming together, let me tell you. It's all coming together.
The number 8 football curse of all time. The Pottsville curse.
Do you believe in curses when it comes to football?
No. No, I don't. No, I don't. Except that one, that Pottsville curse. I believe in that one.
The Cardinals haven't had much luck, and the root of all evil can be traced way back to 1925.
Here's what happened. The Pottsville Maroons won the NFL World Championship. They won it all. The next week, then, they played a college all-star game.
They had agreed to play an exhibition game against a team of Notre Dame all-stars.
It was pro football early days. It was just about the money. So they won the NFL. It's like, okay, let's pick up some extra money. Let's play the college all-stars. Well, the NFL didn't like it. So the NFL voided their championship and gave it to the Chicago Cardinals.
NFL team barnstormed all over the country back then. So to penalize them like that, that was preposterous, unfair.
So Bill Bidwell and the Bidwell family, that curse is on them. And until they return that Super Bowl world title back to the Pottsville Maroons, they're going to continue to have losing season after losing season.
I can't watch this.
It's possible for an entire county or city to collectively send out some black magic against something.
Our number 8 jinx must be strong magic. The Cardinals have had more name changes than division titles.
But they are who we thought they were.
Absolutely the reason why the Cardinals have never won. No different. Of course, it makes all the sense in the world. Had they not gotten screwed over in 1925, things would have been totally different. Neil Lomax wouldn't have gotten sacked so much. Jim Hart wouldn't have gotten sacked so much. It's clear that this curse is true and strong. It's not to be feared.
And Gramatica is dancing up in the air, and it looks like he hurt his knee.
I don't ever root for anybody, but let's just say the Pittsburgh Steelers did us a favor back in 2008, making sure that the curse stayed.
That 100-yard interception return for a touchdown, there had to be some sort of curse on the game for allowing something like that to happen.
Spirits were blocking them. Pottsville. Pottsville saying, no, give us that thing back.
14-point swing. Going to be tough to come back from that.
I think it would be a great idea if the Cardinals and the people of Pottsville got together and let's work through it.
All he has to do is acknowledge that the Pottsville Maroons won this championship in 1925. What is Bidwell even getting out of that? Like, does Bidwell wear a t-shirt that says that 1925 NFL champ?
Boy, it doesn't get any darker.
I could just imagine the Bidwells walking out into the middle of farmland. Okay, we've got your 25 NFL championship. Here's your trophy.
I don't look at it as giving in to the demands of a curse. I look at it as making peace with my enemy. You could call it like spiritual blackmail, if you will. I choose to look at it, well, I'm just trying to make peace and harmony. I bet if you do that, things will change.
Coming up, why has being a Jets fan turned into a living hell?
It's really not a good deal to make a deal with the devil, ever.
You're talking about curses and you don't have the Cleveland Browns on the list? How is that possible?
Cleveland and their Ohio brethren have no creative curse to rally behind. So, we came up with some suggestions. The Browns haven't won since ditching their elf logo in 1969. They are clearly suffering from the Gremlin logo curse.
They're still the Browns. It don't matter.
Across state, when Bengals coach Paul Brown stepped down, the team passed over assistant Bill Walsh to hire Bill Tiger Johnson. Without question, their two Super Bowl losses to the Niners were due to the Tiger Curse.
Into the end zone.
Elves and Tigers don't crack our list, but a presidential tragedy checks in at number 7.
But it's not the end of the world. If we die, we die together.
The number 7 football curse of all time, the Buffalo McKinley curse.
I think a lot of Bills fans truly believe that there is a higher power that does not want Buffalo to win everything.
The genesis of Buffalo woe can be traced back to the turn of the 20th century, when the city had their first chance to shine in a national spotlight.
In 1901, the World's Fair was in Buffalo, New York. Some lunatic shoots the president, William McKinley. He ends up dying in Buffalo.
What does that have to do with anything?
Every time you're right on the cusp, you get to the spotlight, right? You walk right up, and that's when the world is like, remember that time in 1901? Remember that? We gave you that chance. Oh, hold on a second.
We're blaming William McKinley for what happened to a football team 60 to 80 years later. No.
But you realize you were really reaching on this one, right? That's probably the dumbest curse I've ever heard.
Maybe there was a curse before William McKinley. Maybe the curse got William McKinley.
To the people of Buffalo, I'm saying, look, really, just get over it.
Legend says the McKinley assassination condemned the city to fail every time it took the nation's center stage. Their NBA team left town, their NHL team lost the Stanley Cup on a bad call, and their greatest NFL player was disgraced. Then there's the early 90s.
He missed it to the right with 4 seconds to play.
The wide right, will for that's on Buffalo's tombstone.
The Redskins game, star running back forgets his helmet for the first series. Thurman Thomas doesn't even start the game because he can't find his helmet. How does that happen?
You're starting to freak me out a little bit with this.
Kelly's going to throw. Here's Haley. Hit him and picked off in the air and rolls in for a touchdown.
These poor Bills fans. These poor Bills fans, to have this keep happening to them.
There are no flags on the field! Tennessee has pulled a miracle!
Music City Miracle, that could be the fault of the presidential assassination.
It wasn't even like a cool president. It wasn't a president that people remember and like they rally around and there are like special holidays and there are movies. Like Daniel Day-Lewis isn't going to play William McKinley.
Lincoln was assassinated in Washington. Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas. Both franchises have won.
You know, McKinley was not up to the stature of either one of those two guys. So why does Buffalo take the brunt of the cosmic punishment? It's not fair.
This has just been a horrible and horrendous nightmare for the Bills.
That's old. We're in another century now. It's just time to let it go. They need to get a new self-image.
They're saying that after that assassination in 1901, nothing good has come out of Buffalo. Buffalo wings.
Has the Buffalo wings today, baby!
In your face, curse. In your face, McKinley. You're making people fat
you
all over America.
You died in vain.
Number 6 football curse of all time. Broadway Joe's deal with the devil.
So do I believe that Joe Namath actually boozed with the devil? That is just awesome.
If anybody's going to make a deal with the devil, it was number 1 Joe Namath.
We're going to win the game, I guarantee you.
Joe Namath had a conversation with the devil right before that Super Bowl, and he said, devil, if you give me this championship, you don't have to give the Jets anything else for the rest of my life.
I would never recommend making a deal with the devil because literally you're going to have hell to pay.
And why all of a sudden that's becoming evil in me, I don't know.
While contract negotiations are nothing new in the NFL, our number 6 football curse involves a deal between Broadway Joe Namath and the Prince of Darkness.
And I could feel the heat coming from that chair.
He was seething.
You know, I get goosebumps talking about it now. And you know what? I agreed with everything he said. He was right.
With Satan in his corner, Namath defeated the heavily favored Baltimore Colts and was named Super Bowl MVP, despite not throwing a single pass in the fourth quarter.
He's in there! Terrible.
to make a deal with the devil. I mean, there's really no other way.
Jet fans still swear that Joe Namath sold his soul to the devil to beat the Baltimore Colts in Super Bowl III.
The game is over. The New York Jets are the world champions.
Jets haven't won anything since then. So you tell me there's not a curse.
The Jets had their first Super Bowl title, but over the next four decades, they would experience hell on earth.
I can't imagine a poor performance by a New York Jet team.
If you're a Jet fan, you have to approach every season this way. Expect the worst. You're never disappointed.
Because we're not allowed to win. We actually bring Tim Tebow in here, and he doesn't even get on the field. That's God's son.
Our God is an awesome God here.
We're the only franchise in America that would bring Jesus himself in and not use the guy.
All right, thank y'all. God bless.
So I guess at some point, Satan is going to come and claim Joe Namath's soul.
At 70 years old, Joe Namath is taking care of himself and living well, while the Jets are stuck in football purgatory thanks to the number 6 football curse of all time.
And a mix-up in the backfield. Sanchez, has the ball, and down he goes.
If Joe Namath really did make a deal with the devil, then sign me up too, because he's had a pretty darn good life, and he also got a Super Bowl out of this whole thing.
They have upset the Baltimore Colts.
Coming up, a curse so evil, it's not suitable for young viewers.
This movie is rated R. Adult language and violence. Lots of it. Are you kidding me?
They don't like the way we won 34-20.
Before we continue with the cursing, let's take a look back at our countdown so far.
Number 10, the revenge of the honey bears.
Don't mess with the pack of ladies. That's never going to end well.
Number 9, the curse of Billy Penn.
We should have won! Damn it, we should have won this game!
Number 8, Pottsville's pain.
Absolutely the reason why the Cardinals have never won.
But they are who we thought they were!
Number 7, the Buffalo curse.
The Music City Miracle, that could be the fault of the presidential assassination.
Number 6, Joe's deal with the devil.
We're going to win the game, I guarantee it.
And now, the number 5 football curse of all time, Marcus Allen hexes Al Davis.
The most astounding turn of fate.
Are we calling this the Marcus Allen jinx or something?
A Marcus Allen special.
I don't question fate, I just say I appreciate it. It's in my favor, that's all.
Maybe this is a bad idea for you to be airing all these secrets about how to hex somebody. This could totally flip the NFL upside down.
If ever there was a team to delve into the dark arts, it would have to be the Raiders.
We don't quit! We don't die! We just inflict pain!
And the feud between Marcus Allen and Al Davis led to our number 5 football curse.
Al mysteriously stopped playing him. He was one of the greatest running backs in NFL history, and Al kept him on the sidelines.
I thought I was ready to play, and I was doing the job.
So Allen leaves, and he goes to the Chiefs, and what, he puts some sort of voodoo curse on the Raider organization?
He put a picture of Al Davis in the freezer.
Yes, I have heard of that, where people who are trying to stop an enemy will get a jar of water and put a picture of that person in the freezer to freeze them, to stop them. And so, yes, that is truly a ritual of that nature. I'm not trying to teach people black magic, but it's also done with coffee. You could just put them in coffee and freeze them. So I hope he didn't do it, but such a spell actually does exist.
Took a picture out there and put it in the freezer, and that's a hex.
I don't think I've ever seen anything like this.
That's a bunch of crap.
While Marcus Allen earned a place in Canton.
Touchdown for Kansas City. We've got a Kansas City winner.
Poetic justice, that's all it is.
The Raiders haven't won a championship since Allen left the team in 1993.
This is really getting pathetic. What else could go wrong? What else can the Raiders do wrong?
the statistics don't lie, you know, and the situations don't lie.
And while the Raiders once had the highest winning percentage in all of sports, the mystique of the Raiders remains frozen in the past.
I believe that Al, once he found out about his picture being in the freezer, it only fed into his "the world is against me" sort of conspiracy theories. Patriots dynasty was launched with that tuck rule game. How appropriate that it was in the freezer, in the icebox for the Raiders, just like Al was.
After reviewing the play, the quarterback's arm was going forward. It is an 8.
All right. Patriots retain the ball.
Frankly, I wouldn't want a picture of Al Davis anywhere near my freezer. That would just terrify my pudding pops and my frozen peas.
We have no room for our Boca burgers. Now we don't know where to put these things.
Fine. Do we need room for our Boca burgers? They just drafted Jamarcus Russell. Picture's working.
Jamarcus Russell deep in the end zone. Loads it up. Home run ball. Well covered. It's going to be intercepted.
But Al's gone now, so maybe it's time to take it out.
Did you know that Marcus Allen lit the eternal flame at the Raider game, you know, recently?
Al Davis died on October 8th, 2011. And while Marcus Allen may have made amends with his former boss, the mystery and the power of our number 5 football curse lives on.
The number 4 football curse of all time, the SI cover jinx.
It's not true. It's ridiculous. First of all, look at this, man. First of all, is there anything about the swimsuit edition? Is there anything wrong with that? Don't even try to use it as a crutch. You ever hear those models babying themselves? No, it's a curse. I can't be on the front cover. Stop being a damn baby and shut up. There's no such thing as an SI curse.
People just want something to grab onto, I guess, to explain when their team fails.
The SI thing is a lot of hogwash. It's a lot of crap.
I believe in the SI cover jinx because there's just too many examples for you to blow it off.
The SI jinx dates back to the 50s. The first NFL victim was Doak Walker, whose Lions lost 5 straight after he appeared on the cover in 1955.
I think the SI jinx is totally legit. I worked in Kansas City in 2003. The Chiefs are 9-0. Trent Green is on the cover. The fans have a magazine burning to try to release the spirits of the SI jinx. What happens? They lose to the Bengals the next week. The Bengals!
The Chiefs are no longer undefeated?
Even with the burning of the magazine. So I know it's real.
I'll never forget the Tony Mandarich incredible bulk cover. That draft in the top 5, you had Troy Aikman, you had Mandarich, you had Deion Sanders, Derek Thomas, and Barry Sanders. And who gets the cover of Sports Illustrated? Tony Mandarich.
There was a reporter at Sports Illustrated who called Bill Parcells when he was a Giants coach just to start to talk about a story in the magazine. And Parcells cut him off.
Hey, Phil, I'll run the game!
And started yelling at him, no cover, no cover.
What are you chalking up to, right? Because obviously it manifests itself, but why? What physically or emotionally happens when you're on the cover of SI?
I don't believe it's possible to be jinxed by being on the cover of a magazine, but if you believe that you're going to be jinxed by being on the cover, I can guarantee it that you will be jinxed.
It kind of sets you up for failure because you think you've arrived. Once you're on the cover of that magazine, you think, okay, I must be pretty good.
People tend to regress to the mean, so if we're going to put people on this cover that have had a great week, there's a pretty good chance they're going to have a bad week the next week.
Now with these regional covers that SI has, it doesn't have the same kind of flavor.
I'm not trying to jinx you, but I'm done with that.
I almost wish we still had it where you'd wake up Tuesday morning, run to the mailbox, get your Sports Illustrated and say, oh, that team is screwed.
Remember they did that SI cover curse issue? I want to know what happened to the cat after that. Did the cat get sick? Did he throw any interceptions?
Up next, what is the most haunted stadium in the NFL?
This is the dangest thing I've ever seen in a football game right here.
I've never seen anything like this.
Looks like Ghostbusters out here.
What are you going to call?
Do you believe in the the Super Bowl hangover curse. Almost every team that has lost a Super Bowl has suffered misfortune the following season.
Brady's down, and he's in pain. His left knee's holding it.
Just ask the Raiders, who went from the big game in 2002 to a 4-12 record in 2003.
Throws into coverage, deflected up in the air, and intercepted.
And sometimes playing host to a Super Bowl is the problem. As the Super Bowl location curse has prevented any team from ever playing for the Lombardi Trophy in their own stadium.
Drops the football and had it jump back, got it.
But when it comes to jinxed Super Bowl venues, it's hard to look past our next football curse.
The number three football curse of all time, the Superdome curse.
Oh, it's haunted, all right.
This is the dangest thing I've ever seen in a football game right here.
I've never seen anything like this either. It looks like Ghostbusters out here.
Who are you going to call?
No way you can explain it.
While some consider New Orleans a portal into the unknown, the city's Superdome is the subject of our number three football curse of all time.
Well, when the dome was built, that was actually the site of the old Girard Street Cemetery. And they built this facility on there, I think, unwittingly.
They're digging up, they're leveling the ground, they're leveling it, they're digging everything up, and all of a sudden they dig up a corpse. And they're like, what? They think it's another murder in the city.
So they called in the police to see, well, you know, who was murdered here, and then find someone. No, this was a cemetery once upon a time.
And the Saints have done the unthinkable.
And, you know, I don't think that went over very well in the spirit world.
Now, of course, we've got the fantastic Superdome, which without a doubt is the very finest in all the sports.
Opened in 1975, the Superdome was now the home of a struggling NFL franchise.
It's like having open-heart surgery week after week after week without anesthetic.
First 12 years, they didn't make the playoffs in that building.
People made a lot of fun of the Saints in their very bad years, you know, the aints and the bags over the heads.
There is one of the aints. They don't want anyone to know they're identified with their football team.
During the 2000 season, the Saints made a rare playoff appearance, and they were prepared to come to terms with their haunted past.
I was asked to come in to do a blessing for the Saints, who had never won a playoff in their 34-year history. You could feel the energy and the power of those fans praying for the team to get rid of evil in the dome.
On 4th and 14, we'll punt it away. He hangs it very high, angling it for the near sideline. Hakeem drops the ball! Oh. Hakeem drops the ball!
You gotta be kidding me.
It is the New Orleans Saints football! There is a God after all!
And with that, the Saints won the game.
The curse seemed to have been lifted as the Saints beat the defending Super Bowl champs and eventually won a title of their own.
Looks in his direction. It picked off. It's Tracy Porter. He's going to go all the way. The Saints have won the Super Bowl.
But like everything in New Orleans, the Superdome is full of surprises.
But just when you think it's gone away, lo and behold, the biggest game of the season.
They will go all the way, Jacoby Jones.
Why'd the clock stop?
What happens? Blackout.
Somehow a massive outage of power in New Orleans Superdome has put this game on hold.
Only in New Orleans. Only in New Orleans.
How the hell does this happen? This is just insane.
Maybe it was just their way of kind of the spirits kind of reminding folks that we're still around. That little blackout in the middle of the Super Bowl.
Still to come, what is the real reason behind John Madden's fear of flying?
And believe me, John Madden knows about that damn curse. Otherwise, he would fly planes and all kind of stuff.
Tempting fate seems to be the norm for some announcers.
And Anderson hasn't missed in 2 years.
Well, that's a pretty good bet if you say, do you think Gary Anderson will make this field goal? The answer should probably be yes.
39 yards away.
Which leads us to the broadcaster's jinx.
17 touchdowns without a single interception inside the red zone. Tomlinson back to Breeze to the end zone. Picked off by Rondé Barber, and that's the first interception inside the red zone for Breeze this year.
But sometimes the players put themselves in harm's way.
I need some more chunky soup.
Since 1998, the Campbell's Chunky Soup Curse has filled up its own roster of injured players.
Pam not only fumbled it here, John, but he's down. He's hurt.
However, there is an even more dangerous endorsement deal that players involve themselves with.
EA Sports. It's in the game.
The number two football curse of all time, the Madden Cover Curse.
Madden curse, if you're on the cover of John Madden, you get injured the next year or something bad happens to you.
It's taken truly great players and ruined their careers in their prime.
And that's the last thing you want to see is that cart come onto the football field.
To be on the cover of one of the best-selling video game franchises ever and not be happy about it, then it might be a curse.
Madden NFL 97.
Some claim it's just a video game, but the repercussions of our number two football curse of all time cannot be denied.
The list of athletes struck down by the Madden curse is just staggering.
Marshall Faulk was injured.
Well, Marshall's hurt. I think Marshall got hurt.
Dante Culpepper was one.
He's hit. The ball comes loose.
Ray Lewis goes down with an injury.
You all right?
I broke it.
Or what?
Sean Alexander was one of the most durable running backs in the whole league. He got hurt.
Sean Alexander must have rolled up his ankle or something.
Donovan McNabb has one of his worst seasons as a pro.
And McNabb is shaken up.
Vince Young.
Vince is down on the far boundary. Took a header on the concrete.
Vince Young? Anybody seen Vince Young?
Where did it start? You know where it started. Garrison Hurst.
So now they've got to start from deep in their end of the field, and Garrison Hurst takes advantage of it.
And you know the story, one of the great runs of all time, 90-0, Garrison Hurst goes right down the sideline.
And the 49ers have shocked the Jets in overtime.
And that's how his year started, and his year ended with the curse.
And we have an injury right off the bat on Hurst.
Another day, another hard dollar, dog.
Perhaps the biggest victim of the curse was the player who graced the cover of Madden NFL 2004.
It's a nightmare situation as Mike Vick continues to be worked on.
Preseason, Vick breaks his fibula. I mean, even the Madden curse guys, that's a little bit rough.
They got me fired, so I definitely believe that I can blame Madden for that one. John, you got me fired. It's your fault.
Fittingly, no one has appeared on more Madden covers than John Madden himself. But don't think for a minute that he isn't well aware of the risk he's running.
The fact that Madden knew to take himself off the cover tells you something about that curse.
I don't think John wants to be back on that cover.
John Madden doesn't even fly. You think he doesn't know about that damn curse? You think John Madden doesn't know about the Madden curse? He doesn't even fly. There's a freaking bus everywhere. And believe me, John Madden knows about that damn curse. Otherwise, he would fly planes and all kind of stuff.
Have they announced it's over now because of Calvin Johnson?
Especially since Calvin broke the curse last season.
In 2012, Megatron transformed the NFL record books.
Calvin Johnson has just set a single season receiving yards mark.
But he and the Lions still felt the wrath of our number two football curse of all time.
Lions went from being a 10-6 playoff team to being 4-12. So even though Calvin had a great year, there is still a belief in Detroit that the Madden jinx lives on.
The Madden curse goes on and lives on. Madden curse lives on, baby. Come on now.
Up next, our number one football curse.
They just unfortunately suck. That's not very cursed, is it? Okay, maybe it's a little cursed.
Before we end our countdown, let's revisit our list of football curses.
Number 10, ta-ta to the Honey Bears.
That was a classy lot.
Number 9, Billy betrays Billy.
You will lose forever.
Number 8, Maroons, 1925.
All he has to do is acknowledge that the Pottsville Maroons won the championship in 1925.
Number 7, President McKinley vetoes the Bills.
There is a higher power that does not want Buffalo to win everything.
Number 6, Mammoth's soul to take.
He had to make a deal with the devil. I mean, there's really no other way.
Number 5, Marcus Allen hexes Al Davis.
A Marcus Allen special!
Number 4, the SI cover curse.
No cover. No cover.
Number 3, the Superdome curse.
Oh, it's haunted, all right.
Number 2, Madden cover carnage.
The Madden curse goes on and lives on.
And now, the number one football curse of all time. The curse of Bobby Lane.
The curse of Bobby Lane is he is, if not for Barry Sanders, the single greatest Lion in history.
He was larger than life on and off the field. He led the team in every way. He led them from the goal line to the end zone to the bar after the game.
1957, he breaks his leg. They go on to win the championship with Tobin Rhode at quarterback. They then trade Bobby Lane to the Pittsburgh Steelers.
And on his way out of town, he said the Lions won't win anything for 50 years.
Talk about sour grapes. This team won't win for 50 years, he said.
Lane cracks the top spot on our list, not for his sour grapes, but his very large grapes.
You're a stud when you can predict your own curse. Babe Ruth didn't try to put a curse on the Red Sox. They talk about the SI jinx or the Madden curse. Well, they didn't try for this. Bobby Lane did it. He cursed the Lions.
Do you have, like, witch's blood in your veins, Bobby Lane?
I think Detroit bought into it. You know, they're reading this, right? Reading this constantly, so they're feeding their minds, their hearts, so they're going to set themselves up for failure.
The Lions have had plenty of failure. In the 50 years following the Bobby Lane trade, they won just one playoff game.
Touchdown, Sterling Sharp!
And in a development that would no doubt make Bobby Lane smile, it's the quarterback position that has held them back.
For me to explain all the quarterbacks that I've covered in the time I've covered the Detroit Lions, it would be like a 10-year box set of The Sopranos.
Eric Hipple.
Chuck Long.
Scott Mitchell. Gary Danielson.
Rusty Hilger.
I never even heard of Rusty Hilger before that, okay? I never even knew who he was, and I covered the league.
Jeff Comlo.
Stoney Case.
The great Andre Ware.
Eric Kramer. Stop me when you've heard enough cursed quarterbacks here.
Charlie Batch.
Joey Harrington.
Don Majkowski.
Dan Orlovsky.
We had a kid named Mike McMahon. We had, you know, on and on it goes.
Not one quarterback in one Pro Bowl since the early 70s? I think that says the curse is real.
Not Jason.
The Bobby Lane curse was only supposed to last 50 years.
They needed to get through that 50 years. Just get through it.
He may have outdone himself because we're beyond 50 years.
So they go 50 years, and then the 51st year, the Lions go 0-16. A donut the other way, the wrong way.
I mean, that's an exclamation point. Oh, yeah, you thought we were messing around for a little bit. But here you go. Served up. Worst team ever. What you gonna do now?
How do you go about negotiating the end of a curse?
So you gotta break the curse somehow, right? Is it holy water? Or what do you do to break curses? I don't know.
In 2009, the team finally attempted to appease Bobby Lane and end our number one ranked curse once and for all.
The Detroit Lions select Matthew Stafford.
The Lions draft this kid who not only went to Highland Park High School, where Bobby Lane is from, he lived on the same street.
The party is on, my friend.
Hollywood will fall all over itself when Matthew Stafford finally leads the Lions to a Super Bowl victory. And you have the man who broke the curse of Bobby Lane that came from the same high school as Bobby Lane. You can't script it any better than that.
Way to go, baby. We got a lot to do.
My advice to the teams who have been victims of curses is, first of all, you have to believe that the power of good is stronger than the power of evil. But above all, stop saying you're cursed.
I'm cursed.
Because the more you say it, the realer it gets.
I'm 100% cursed.
Start saying, I'm blessed. I'm a victor. I'm gonna win.
This is the year, baby. 19-0. Believe it.
You know, these are the kind of things, but don't keep saying something that happened 100 years ago, because you're gonna get more of it.